So I'm delighted to introduce our panel for today. And we have a fantastic group who are going to run through some of the opportunities and then provide some insights on the Canadian technology in the Canadian banking sector. So I'm delighted to introduce Hugh McKee, who is head of BMO Partners, BMO Financial Group. And I'm delighted to introduce Lyle El-Hadi, who's the executive director of FinTech Cadence in Montreal. I'm delighted to introduce Paul Childerhose, who's the founder of Maple Peak Group and also a board member of the Canadian RegTech Association, which Invest Northern Ireland here in the Americas is a member of. And finally, I'm also delighted to introduce Adam Swinemar, who's the Senior VP of Digital Product and Marketing at Laurentian Bank of Canada. Adam is having some telco issues, so he's dialed in very kindly. So you'll hear his voice. I'm not sure if you'll be able to see him. We're delighted to have all of the panelists here. So we'll kick off, and what I'd like to quickly do is maybe have each panelist give a very quick introduction to themselves, and we will start with Hugh. So Hugh, maybe you could give us a quick intro to yourself and your role at BMO.
Sure, happy to do so. And I think maybe just building on what Alex was saying, first of all, BMO, we're the Bank of Montreal. By the name, you may think we're some regional bank focused on Montreal. The reality is we're actually the eighth largest bank in North America, have a substantial footprint across North America, as well as in Asia and in Europe. I run what's called BMO Partners, which is focused on the relationships we build with fintechs, with big tech, with incubators, accelerators, and industry consortia.
Thanks, Hugh. I'll ask Lyle if she wants to introduce herself from FinTech Cadence. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Michael, for having us here today and for giving us the opportunity to introduce our organization. As you've mentioned, I'm the executive director of FinTech Cadence, a nonprofit organization based in Montreal, but focusing on the Canadian FinTech ecosystem and the development of very early stage startups. Our main focus is to collaborate directly with financial institutions and see some of the challenges or opportunities that they've identified and linking them to early stage startups as well as a key component of what we do. But we also work and focus solely as on the other flip side on startups and their development, helping them raise early capital, but also helping them with their product development and talent selection as well. And lastly, we educate and have conversations around very pertinent topics that are happening in FinTech as well. And so we're really trying to, as I mentioned, bring all stakeholders together across Canada to make sure that Canada has a robust FinTech ecosystem.
Great, thanks so much. Maybe Adam, if you'd like to introduce yourself and your work at Laurentian Bank.
Sure, thanks, Michael, and good, I guess, morning or afternoon, everyone. And again, apologies, I'm unable to be on video. So Adam Swinemar, I'm the SVP of Digital Product and Marketing at Laurentian Bank. I have enterprise accountability for the bank's digital strategy as well as digital operations. And I also oversee the retail product and marketing function. Laurentian Bank, as you saw from Alex's presentation, would be considered a regional bank. We celebrated our 175th year anniversary. So we are a longstanding bank founded out of the province of Quebec, but also have gone across Canada with our digital solution across and have services across retail, business banking, wealth and investment services. And again, pleasure to be here.
Thank you, Adam. It's much appreciated. And finally, but not least, our good friend, Paul Childerhose of the Canadian RegTech Association.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone, and good morning. Bonjour to Lael. My name is Paul Childerhose, representing on this call the Canadian Regulatory Technology Association. And this is a Canadian-based, neutral, not-for-profit association started by a woman by the name of Donna Bales back in December of 2018. We have Michael and I have known each other for a number of years, but as it relates to Invest Northern Ireland, they are a member of the Canadian RegTech Association. So there's certainly much that we can do. I'm a board member and I work closely with Michael. So as it relates to any of the companies or representatives on the call, we can certainly talk about that during this conversation. Separately, I spent about 15 years working at RBC and Scotiabank, doing regulatory programs for BCBS 239, for the SEC in New York. I had to do some work with RBC Capital Markets. The last 2 years was in anti-money laundering with Scotiabank. So my background is largely regulatory data management projects on behalf of risk or the business. I decided 2 years ago to leave the bank full-time and return to my company full-time. which is Maple Peak Group, and I incorporated 15 years ago on June 12, 2006. The focus of my little company is largely working with startups, fintechs, regtechs, founders and CEOs of Canadian and international companies, just to help them understand the Canadian landscape. I don't profess to be all things to all people, rather I just use and leverage my experience within banking to help with understanding the nuances of trying to make it into this marketplace. Thank you, Michael.
Thanks very much, Paul. Much appreciated. So we'll go on and we'll kick it off. And I'd like to sort of open the first question. I'm going to open it to Adam at Laurentian. And suppose, Adam, from your previous experience at working at Scotia and now at Laurentian, just which areas of technology do you consider to be the highest priority for you at Laurentian right now? And how do you see that changing in the next few years?
Sure. Thanks, Michael. I would say for us at Laurentian, and I suspect not that different from some of the other banks, you know, the pandemic over the last year and a half has certainly created demand for technologies that help facilitate better collaboration, whether that's with our employees internally or with customers. And so we've been increasing our focus on, you know, digitizing things around onboarding and document exchange and, you know, more robust tools, I would say, around KYC and AML. Certainly, you know, also continuing to, you know, be vigilant around cybersecurity and fraud prevention. You know, we're obviously starting to see, you know, more of a rise around those types of attacks. And then I think Alex mentioned in terms of, you know, areas of focus around sort of payments and where the payments landscape is going, and the importance of payments is certainly sort of an area of focus for us also right now. In terms of moving forward, I would say, you know, we see and expect to see more, focus around data and analytics capabilities, certainly, you know, AI, machine learning, in terms of where we are with the bank and trying to automate more effectively and really look at how we can leverage better data and insights. And I think that'll become, you know, increasingly more important, especially as we see more businesses and consumers digitize, you know, how we, you know, leverage that data to provide a better experience, both within our digital channels and then more seamlessly bridging between digital and physical. So those, I would say, for Laurentian would certainly be sort of current and future areas of focus for us.
That's very helpful. And I asked the same question of Hugh, but with your Bank of Montreal hat on, you could shed some light on that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think Adam's covered a lot of it. Is I would say the thing that's a reality is we've been on a digital transformation journey for probably 4 or 5, 6 years. No question that COVID has accelerated that. And there's really two broad components to that. One is the digitization of service. And I think you've seen all Canadian banks push very hard on that, pushing that type of activity out of branches into digital self-serve environments. And then increasingly really focusing on digital sales. And I think the evolution I think within digital sales is it's gone from being relatively simple products, let's say like cards, to now more complex products like mortgages, as an example. I think another theme for us and for others is a shift towards cloud, much more of a greater willingness to actually support that. And I think we'll probably talk more about that in a minute. Certainly we're in the midst of more open architecture, more sort of API-based approach to how we work with external players. And then I think, as Adam sort of mentioned as well, like, you know, AI, machine learning, all those kinds of things, we've created a center of excellence. We're using that in a variety of ways for us, the bank. And are spending a lot more time, I would say, and also other activities that I kind of broadly call run the bank. And so whether that's cybersecurity or reg tech or marketing tech or whatever, there's sort of a variety of things in there. And then the final one, which I think is different and certainly has been brought in the last year or so, again, is sort of how we work. So I think most of the banks are, and most employers are, sort of shifting to likely a different model, and that's going to be permanent and therefore requires some differences in terms of how we work.
That's brilliant. It's very helpful. Hugh, some great insight. Leal, I suppose with those sort of areas that Hugh and Adam have touched upon, and obviously with your work with fintechs here in Canada, would you have anything to add to that, or I know any sort of advice for those these companies that are on the call taking their first step at looking at approaching some of these organizations?
Yeah, I mean, I think what Adam and Hugh mentioned really syncs up with some of the startups that we're seeing emerge. I know there's a big drive around cybersecurity. Last year, the digital transformation component was large startups trying to address that and trying to support financial institutions in the back end to help them accelerate that as well has been a big component. And as I think I believe Hugh also mentioned, you know, the work from home transformations and the cloud services, that's been key and very indicative of the kind of startups that we're seeing. Maybe what else I'll just add, and I think it was Adam who mentioned it, or excuse me, Alex who mentioned it earlier regarding the segments that are really growing here in Canada, and payments has and always will be one of the strong verticals that we see. So there's also a huge component around that, especially what's happening with the real-time rails. And I won't get into that, not to drone on there, but if anyone's interested, I highly encourage you to go onto Payment Canada's website. They have phenomenal resources on the implication of real-time rails and how that's going to impact a lot of Canadian consumers and financial institutions, of which are represented here today. So that's another, maybe one other element that I see that maybe wasn't highlighted too much here. And then in terms of advice that I have, I mean, I could talk for talk for hours on the best way to start working with financial institutions and the way to start the conversations around this. But I think what's really key for the startups here, and then I know, Michael, we're going to get into it a little bit later, but I think what's really key for the startups who are interested in working with BMO or Laurentian or any other financial institution is to really understand when they identify that these are some of the areas and the technologies that they're interested in, what is the value that you can bring in from a startup perspective, to also respect the fact that financial institutions have a lot of internal innovation strategies or a lot of internal solutions that they're working on as well. So how to be ready to truly understand which component of these challenges that they're facing. And then another thing which we talk about enormously here in Canada is for fintechs to be ready to work with the compliance challenges as well with working with financial institutions. So making sure that they're also ready to provide solutions, but understanding the restrictions that some of these financial institutions have to face when it comes to data security, cybersecurity, and compliance issues as well.
That's very helpful. And I suppose, Paul, with your reg tech hat on, and obviously Hugh mentioning reg tech being an area, would you have any advice again for a Northern Irish reg tech company that was looking to come into the Canadian market and trying to work with one of the big six or one of the regional banks?
Certainly. I think I would highlight an Irish-based company like First Derivatives. My experience, I know Standy Collins here in Toronto, that I believe is the Canadian representative for First Derivatives. So I think it's really important when you're coming into this market to work with a known entity. So certainly First Derivatives fits that, or PwC, a global conglomerate like PwC. I think they have an office in Belfast, a center of expertise there, especially in the area of something like financial crimes. If within the Canadian RegTech Association, we'll look at different the taxonomy pertaining to different areas of RegTech. So, I would say the banks continue to spend an inordinate amount of money on financial crimes risk management. So, everyone on this call is very familiar with Finergo and what that organization has built. So I think they have five of the six, or maybe all big six banks are using Finergo now as far as the onboarding of their wholesale business. I think they're trying to get into the retail side as well, but that would be another suggestion. Like if you called up Mr. Murphy or somebody over there at Finergo and spoke to them, because they are already entrenched. So any little reg tech, startup, fintech, payment tech, you're just going to be part of a bigger tech stack within an organization like BMO or TD or wherever, right? So you're not going to be able to really make traction by going in as an independent. It's tough. You have to look at it from the perspective of the entire tech stack, focus on reg tech, focus on AML, financial crimes. Maybe a little firm like FinTrue, I think they're an Irish-based company, I believe, Mike. So they supply resources to do a lot of remediation or staff augmentation. So a company like that can get in and do some remediation. There's no shortage of quote-unquote remediation work at these banks, whether be related to the U.S. and remediation they have to do for the New York Fed or New York DFS or here in OSFI, FinTrack, OSFI. I mean, the regulators do their job, but quite honestly, the opportunities around some of the stuff Hugh was talking about, I'm glad to hear, like as it relates to AI, machine learning, open knowledge graph, all of these technologies and opportunities to actually enhance the effectiveness and the efficiency. I know the gentleman that's working at Laurentian Bank right now, you know, I know some folks at Laurentian that are in the AML space there. So I hear about some of the challenges, and those challenges are not unique to Laurentian Bank. I spent 2.5 years remediating things at Scotiabank, where the bank was spending, you know, 50-100 million bucks a year on remediation, but largely that money went to consulting companies. So if you have a really slick offering, some technology that may enhance the effectiveness or the efficiency of how an organization, especially at the back end on the operations, like as it relates to something like case management, you know, any of these big platforms, they're really just churning out a lot of false alerts, right? So if you're in a position and you can help to optimize that, I'd call out a company like, you know, somebody like Quantexa is based out of the UK, Sayari Labs. These are the types of fintechs to me that are doing really, really cool stuff. And what we would do, Mike, through the Canadian RegTech Association, there's no cost. I don't think so. I'm a board member. We wouldn't, like any company in Ireland that's affiliated with your organization, Michael, Invest Northern Ireland, they get a free platform. We'll feature them on webinars, podcasts, newsletters, any of that stuff.
Brilliant. We'll certainly take you up on that, Paul. That's probably a good segue actually back to Hugh and to Adam as well. We might just skip a section, but just going on to something that Paul touched on, how BMO's approach to partnerships with international fintechs, Hugh, I'd be really interested to sort of understand that. And then, you know, any advice perhaps you would have to our companies online. And I'll actually ask the same question to Adam as well, but maybe Hugh, if you want to lead with that.
Yeah, like I think the comments that Paul made, I think are accurate. Like I would say, like I think we're reasonably agnostic as to location. Like it doesn't, like, are we expecting you to be in Canada or not? Probably not that important. But I would say, depending on the nature of what you do, the barrier to entry gets quite high. Like for a variety of reasons, I think we're better off dealing with what I would call enterprise grade companies. So companies that have a really robust InfoSec capability, as mentioned as well, you know, compliance capabilities, ones that have proven themselves working with other FIs, that is important. One of the first things I did when I got into this job is I had to write off a, you know, multi-million dollar partnership because they basically couldn't manage the InfoSec requirements. I do think a really viable approach is working with an intermediary. That could be it could be like the, you know, a technology consultant, but it could also be MasterCard or Adobe or whatever, where there's some intermediation with a partner that we sort of know and understand that can actually be quite helpful. And then I would also think about what, you know, sort of what's the low fidelity proof of concept. So that's one thing I'm always looking for is there a way for us to try this thing out without an extensive technology investment, without having to provide access to extensive data or to operating systems, things like that. So those are some of the ideas that I would have, Michael.
That's very helpful, Hugh. And Adam, I'd bring you in from the Laurentian's perspective, maybe to add some color from there.
Yeah, I would say very, very similar theme to, I think, Paul and Hugh's comments. And even, you know, we're also, I would say, agnostic to location. I would say, though, you know, would want to understand, you know, that there's proven sort of experience working within the Canadian environment, specifically to Leal's points earlier about understanding, you know, the regulatory frameworks, you know, and being able to operate within, you know, the compliance and data privacy sort of constraints that we have. I think, you know, we would want to see some prior, you know, experience working with other financial institutions as well, I think. But maybe where we might be a little different than bigger banks, and I suspect, you know, credit unions, you know, we're you know, a bank like Laurentian doesn't often have the same scale, and in many cases, the same core IT capabilities that, you know, maybe some of the larger banks, certainly, you know, Scotia that I came from. And so, you know, we will often at Laurentian be looking for how can we supplement, our our core competencies with potential partnerships where we can, you know, get the market faster. And so I would say, you know, that could be an opportunity, whether it's through, you know, smaller banks or smaller credit unions could be another way into the Canadian market. But I would agree with you for sure that if you're a relatively unknown entity, you know, working with an intermediary that either has an existing relationship with that institution or is more known in the market could be an easier way in to get through some of those barriers.
That's brilliant, Adam, and again, very, very helpful information. I suppose, and I'll go to Liel and sort of, you know, framing it from what the two gentlemen have spoke about, but looking at it from another perspective, are there areas for fintechs from Northern Ireland and technology companies from Northern Ireland to collaborate with academic research centers or innovation hubs here in Canada to use that as a channel as well, perhaps, to get in front of some of these big organizations?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, that's kind of not to toot our own horn, but that's exactly what we try and do within Fintech Cadence. And I know there's multiple organizations that do very similar things. DMZ out of Toronto, Mars out of Toronto as well, District 3 out of Montreal. And so I'm just going to name a few for those who are listening in case they're interested: Harvest Calgary and Cultivator out of and Colabs out of Saskatchewan as well. So there's lots of organizations in Canada that are focusing on building that. We're very aware that the Canadian market is very small, and we are also very aware that there's a lot of global fintechs that are going to be looking at Canada as a very interesting market. And so our services and programs are geared specifically around that. As long as there is a direct impact and a direct correlation to either Canadian consumers or Canadian financial institutions or Canadian companies, a lot of these organizations, incubators and accelerators will work and help to support these fintechs organizations. And I maybe just want to echo here what Adam is saying. Sometimes it's very difficult to come in, especially from another country into Canada, and try and work with the larger banks. And that's really where we encourage fintechs to look at credit unions or smaller institutions. So directly agreeing with Adam there, it's also really important to understand the process of closing deals with financial institutions at large. It is a longer period. We've talked about it quite a bit already. There is a due diligence, there is regulatory constraints as well. So also to come in with the understanding that it's going to take a while to build a relationship so that the ecosystem and the network knows who you are to help build with the credibility. But then further to that then there's also a long sales cycle with financial institutions because of the restrictions and the parameters they have to navigate as well. So it's also coming into Canada, identifying which kind of organization is the best fit for you in terms of understanding the verticals and the support that they can provide. And then further to that, understanding that how the sales cycle works so that you can also come in prepared and understand what you're really going to be navigating when you enter.
That's very helpful again, Leo. Thanks so much. And I think there's some really good advice in there. We're going to switch gears slightly and talk about an area.
I was just going to say one thing, literally 10 seconds. Yeah. For the audience here, for any of the regtechs, fintechs over in Ireland, just take a look. Just Google B10 OSFI regulation. So this pertains to the outsourcing of all business activities, functions, and processes. So here in Canada, all of the regulated entities, banking entities, they need to comply with B10, which is a critical regulation here. And it focuses specifically on third-party risk management. So what they're going to look, what a financial institution like Laurentian or RBC, any of the banks here, Hughes, of course, I mean, from a procurement perspective, just trying to get through an organization through the procurement channel, if you're able to speak about B10 specifically, they're going to ask you about, you know, the banks need to be able to assess the risk associated with third-party vendors, right? So they're going to look at assessing the risk, the viability of that vendor, incident management. They're going to look at data security, data access. They're going to look at sort of the continuity of critical operations, so the ability for your organization to support a financial institution if there's some critical pandemic like COVID, how do you support them? And then from a cloud risk management perspective, if you're moving all of your services up there as a platform, as a service, software as a service, you need to think about how the financial institution is going to assess you. Even before they care about your product, they really don't care because they're just truly looking at you as a vendor and understanding how difficult is it going to be for them to adhere to B10 relative to you as a vendor.
That's great. No, that's very, very, very helpful, Paul. I'm definitely able to get more information on that. I think that's very good, great advice. I did want to switch gears quickly to a topic about cloud adoption, which Hugh had touched upon earlier, and maybe go back to Hugh, but just about the attitude, and you can speak to obviously from a BMO, but the adoption of cloud and software as a service among banks and financial institutions in Canada. I would really just to get your perspective on that. And again, obviously to Adam, Leal and Paul as well.
Yeah, I think you've sort of highlighted it, which is just a significant shift in how we think about that. I would say not that long ago when I was first looking at partnerships that, you know, everything had to be on our premises, on our systems, then sort of evolution to a BMO cloud and now externally. And mm-hmm. thankfully, we just publicly announced last week that we're doing a significant deal with AWS as our sort of preferred cloud provider. And these things are very extensive now. So it's going to modernize the banking platforms we're using. It's going to help with data analytics, with machine learning, with storage, you know, better sort of streamline efficiency. A lot of the capability is how do you sort of unlock, like our bank has been around for 200 years, right? So how do you unlock the data and the insights you've got with something like that? We're porting over all of our online and mobile banking onto those platforms. It's going to be a platform that will help support things like remote work. So I would say it took us a long time to get there, or it felt like it did. But now I sort of feel like everyone's accelerating into that direction, Michael.
That's great. And Adam, from Laurentian's perspective, I know when we spoke before the panel, you obviously you're new to Laurentian, but you sort of mentioned you're beginning your journey.
Yeah, I mean, even from my days at Scotiabank, echo kind of Hugh in terms of, seeing the evolution of just the way we moved from, you know, on-prem and just the attitude to, you know, even just partnerships in general, I would say with fintechs, you know, seeing that sort of evolve and a much more willingness to sort of go that direction. At Laurentian, we're much more, I think, in the early stages. And so, you know, our attitude to cloud is positive. I don't think we've made as much movement as maybe Hugh has at BMO, but certainly would agree with the benefits. We do have an intention to leverage more cloud-based solutions and SaaS solutions as an organization, but still very much in the infancy of executing against that. But it's definitely part of the overall technology strategy as we look to digitize and go through the transformation.
That's brilliant to hear and great to sort of see that adoption. I suppose then, Paul, very quickly, in terms of the type of companies that are joining the association, are you seeing a lot more in that sort of space? Is that more of a trend now, or what are you seeing from the vendor perspective?
Just to paraphrase that, the question is
vendors are working in the cloud, yeah.
Well, certainly from our association standpoint, we have the three largest CSPs there. So we have Google, we have Azure, Microsoft, we have AWS. So those are three of the largest cloud service providers. We also have a firm based out of Toronto here, Raymond Dong and Artin. They've co-founded a company called SkyMantle Technologies. SkyMantle Technologies, they build on top of AWS, I believe Azure as well. That's a pretty cool company. They're a member of RegTech Association, and they actually are building wealth tech platforms for some other companies. So a company like Portfolio 8, Sam Webster, he founded that company. Lee Kavenko, CTO. So they outsource the build of their wealth tech to the guys at SkyMantle. SkyMantle is also just as a point of reference, they are building the Canadian RegTech directory, which is going to be separate standalone service for any of our RegTech members. They can promote their stuff within that directory. They're providing that to us at no charge. So it's going to be powered by SkyMantle Technologies. But I would say relative to cloud data management, the third party risk is a huge component. We responded as an association to OSFI's technology risk consultation, which ran from September 15th to December 15th of last year. So there were six core areas that OSFI was focused on. Our role within the Canadian RegTech was to engage with our members that are within the tech community. So OSFI will traditionally look at the regulated entities. What we do, we have a partner, not a partnership, they wouldn't call it that, but OSFI engaged the RegTech Association to engage with our tech community. So we did work with the three cloud providers, one of the law firms, Miller Thompson, and we specifically went through, I think it was section four of the survey. There was about five or six questions related to cloud service providers and associated risks with using that, because OSFI is trying to gain a sense of where things are. So cloud adoption, hybrid clouds, yeah, a lot of banks are doing it. Some are quite behind, quite honestly. When I look at where they stand now, I won't name the name of the bank, but they happen to be green. They're really, some of these organizations are spending an inordinate amount of money on trying to lift and shift from data warehouses, from Hadoop and all that stuff into the cloud. There's an organization called the Enterprise Data Management Council. In July, they're launching the Cloud Data Management Capability Assessment Model. Okay, and that is going to be a free license for anybody. I'm working with OSFI, with Andrew Miller, Chief Data Officer over at OSFI right now, because this is really, really critical stuff, Michael. So I don't know about, I don't know if I answered your question, but I spoke for too long.
No, that's fine, Paul. I think you're getting across the importance of the regulatory piece here in the Canadian market, which I think everyone needs to be aware of. And I really appreciate that.